that's today, okay? So, you know, it's like, if you think about like what this means for the future, the facts suggest that even if it feels like we're kind of here, and maybe we are kind of there with progress, that like this really could be coming, that this is kind of what's happened. I mean, it's just very intuitive to us to feel that it's naive to think that what I'm saying is naive, it's intuitive, right? Because we don't think in, we're not good at thinking in exponential curves, okay, first of all. So first of all, if someone says, okay, so here's the present day, just say, and here's a date in the future, where are we gonna be with progress? And our intuition is to think more linearly. Okay, well, just say that's, you know, 100 years ahead, or 30 years ahead. Let's go 30 years behind and kind of see the slope of the, how much has happened in the last 30 years, let's add it to the next 30 years, okay? It's a trajectory based on the past growth rate. Someone else might say, well, it's actually been moving a little bit faster. Well, recently, it gets faster over time. Let's base it on the rate that it's actually going today. Okay, both bad predictions, because exponential curves work more like this. Okay, so you have to, it's not intuitive to us. Just like compound growth, you know, with investing is not intuitive to us. That's why people are bad investors. But there's another reason, in that for all of human history, the world that our brains were optimized to understand, things didn't change quickly. Your great, 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 great grandparents basically lived the same lives that you did. Okay, and so conventional wisdom was wise. You know, if someone says don't eat that berry, don't eat that berry. And if someone else came around and said, these are the end of days, you know, I saw the comet and this is gonna be, they were always wrong. So we're kind of wired to have the wise intuition to think that it's naive that someone's saying that things are going crazy, that's gonna be nuts. But the book I just showed you is real. Okay, so we have to override our wiring. Look at the book. Page 500 is nuts. We are part of the craziest thriller movie right now, and it's just going really slowly. And we were born on page 500, which we think it's normal, and we can't see it because we're just walking, you know, it's Wednesday, now it's Thursday, we can't see. If you could just speed up time, you'd be like, oh my God, you know, get the popcorn out. So, you know, you can look at the actual evidence of this in a lot of places. Okay, so we have VR, not sure why that's the slide there. And it was a slide like a long time ago when I was in a rush and I just kind of gotten attached to it as now is the VR slide. So VR, AR, people think of, you know, predict to be bigger than TV and movies combined by 2025. It seems kind of crazy, but things are moving really quickly, okay? And there's, you know, differing views on this, but the concept that, you know, we might live in a world where it's just very, very normal to kind of not be where your body is a lot of the time. That's really, really dramatically different, okay? You know, I'm not an expert on what's going on with genetic engineering and CRISPR, but the articles I've read, the people I've talked to, it's crazy. I mean, people, your grandkids are gonna say to you, they're gonna say, so you just had a baby and hoped it was a good baby? It's gonna sound really old fashioned, but really just, you know, and you know, you were saying, you know, your grandmother got pregnant. I mean, like an animal? Like, yeah, she was pregnant like an animal. That's what we used to do, okay? You know, so just all the possibilities that start to pop up when you think about, we can edit our genes, okay? Nanotechnology, just be able to manufacture on smaller and smaller scales. You know, if you can move atoms around, you can make anything very easily. One of the many, many applications of this that I have had a chance to dive into is, you know, brain-machine interfaces. I wrote a long article about this. And this is nuts. I mean, this is you know, this is what Elon Musk is working on and a bunch of other people right now, but it's kind of under the, you know, behind the scenes, so we're not hearing much about it. But I mean, the idea is eventually we want to be able to have your neurons in your brain. They're just sending information. You know, that's your eyes are cameras that receive information, and the only place they can project that is into your visual cortex. Your ears are little microphones. The only place they can project that is into your auditory cortex. And the only place your thinking can happen is contained within your brain, and your thoughts are kind of stuck in there, okay? What if you could put some kind of really fancy interface in, wireless, and, you know, lasts forever, and it just communicates whatever your neurons are saying. It sends them out. Sends them out to a computer, sends them out to someone else's brain machine interface in their head. You could suddenly think with each other. You can see what my eyes are seeing. Crazy. This just gets it just gets really intense, and you can manipulate your brain. So things like, you know, depression or hunger, these are chemical. We can manipulate those things. Endless possibilities. But I think, and then we have also the aliens, like, they're going to fucking Mars on the end of page 500. He's just like, the leaps for life this big, you know, you count on one hand. So again, this is objective. I'm not being like now centrist. I'm just being objective that going from no life to life, pretty big deal for life. Going from simple cells to complex cell, the nucleus, big leap. Okay, complex cells to multi-cell organisms, big leap. Yeah. Ocean animals to land, big leap. One planet to two planets. I mean, that does warrant a pinky finger here. We're gonna be alive for that. It's just, you have to just step back and understand that, like, nothing is normal. And that's kind of fun. It also is not that crazy that you happen to be born at this time, because this is it's when things get crazy that the population probably will balloon out, which means many people. It's likely, actually, more likely to be born now than any other time. And this, to me, is crazier than all those other things combined. And so we're gonna talk about this. And then, you know, I know that you have a varying level of understanding. And some of you know more than I do about AI, and some of you probably know a lot less. So I'm gonna be trying to go through the general overview, because it's, I think we wanna get up to a certain level so that at least we can have intelligent conversations about it. So first, just to clarify, you know, in this city, I don't need to do this slide as much, but let's do it anyway. What is AI? It's people still associated with robots. Robots are the container for the AI. Robots are hardware. Okay. Also, there's a robotics revolution going on as well, separately. That's obviously very, intertwined with AI. But AI is software, specifically software that's designed to make intelligent decisions or accurate predictions in some problem domain. Okay, and the thing that you cannot understand AI without really wrapping your head around is the distinction between breadth of intelligence and magnitude of intelligence. So you have, I think a lot of people, when they think about intelligence and how smart something is, they're just thinking about kind of one axis, okay? But of course, this is super oversimplistic too. It's extremely complicated, you know? Weird people tell me, they love to tell me that octopuses are smarter than humans or something. It's just clearly not true. I don't know why they would say that. But anyway, intelligence is complicated. And so if you think about it, just say on the x-axis, you have breadth. Okay, all the different things you can be intelligent in, the different kinds of intelligence you can have. And on the y-axis, we have how intelligent you are at that thing. So that gives us these terms. Narrow intelligence is being a certain level of smart at one thing, maybe at two things, okay? General intelligence is being just kind of smart, being intelligent across the board. So humans, you know, compared to, things that computers might be able to do, we're a little bit low. We're higher than other animals, but we're a little bit low because biology is limited, but we have really awesome general intelligence. We can learn from experience. We have creativity. We have social skills. We have, we can learn as we go along. We can be smart in basically any area if you give us some time. That's general intelligence. And it kind of brings with it the concept that we think of as consciousness. You know, it's a debate whether general intelligence always comes from consciousness. But that kind of concept of consciousness could only exist in a general intelligent creature. It couldn't exist in a narrow intelligent creature. So this is us, and where is AI right now? Okay? It's here. So AI is everywhere. It's just narrow. It's all narrow right now. Every single AI in the world is narrow. But it's really good at what it does. It's way, way better than us at the thing it's narrow at. So you have, like, you know, this is one of those things where the guy who coined the term AI gets very sassy and upset. He says that once it works, no one calls it AI anymore. That's true, actually. But AI is everywhere. You know, your car, you're not thinking about the system that, you know, the fine-tunes the fuel injection parameters as you drive, anti-lock brakes parameters. You're not thinking about that, but someone's thinking about it, the AI, Okay, those things are changing on the fly. Okay, you know, when you buy a flight, you're not thinking about who set that price. AI set the price. You're not thinking about what gate you land in. Who assigned that? Some traffic controller? No, AI decides what gate you land in. Okay, when you buy something on Amazon and it says people who bought this also bought, you know, or recommend something to you, that's not like some employee in Amazon being like, Jim, I've been thinking about him. I think he would like this. No, that is obviously AI. Your Facebook newsfeed, AI, Google search, AI. And you know, all these other industries that probably many of you are not involved in, military, manufacturing, finance, expert systems for hospitals, things like you know, Watson that was on Jeopardy. Watson is actually for doctors. It's an expert system that you know can learn a ton of stuff and spit out information. So you can go on and on. Almost every app in your phone probably is using some form of AI. It's absolutely everywhere. And the question is, what's gonna happen with ANI? Okay, artificial narrow intelligence. Let's start there. Okay, we'll move on to the crazier stuff in a second, but just in the next, you know, I need to update that to 18, but just in the next 7 years, okay? 7 years, we're saying, 7 years ago, it was 2011, like, that's not long ago. So we're talking about, like, something that you're gonna look kind of the same as you do now, then, okay? But the world's gonna be really different. I mean, this is, ANI alone is dramatically changing the world very, very quickly. So let's just go through a few examples of how this is happening to just kind of like, you know, remind us that this has happened. So gaming is a famous example because it gets a lot of press. So you probably, a lot of you have heard of DeepMind, which was acquired by Google. And so the first time before we started hearing about DeepMind, we were hearing about Deep Blue, which was an expert chess master, AI. And, you know, AI had beaten humans at simple games. They, you know, obviously, you know, super simple, you get to something like tic-tac-toe, you can just perfect it, and AI can perfect things like that, because there's not many degrees of freedom. So yeah, you can just try everything and see what the best move is. Chess is a little bit more complicated. There's a lot of different ways a chess board can go, and people said that chess is an art, not just a science, and there's too many ways it can go. A computer will never beat a human at chess. They said this many, many times. 1996, the world chess master lost to an AI. So now, download any chess app on your phone, and it's got AI that would beat 100 world masters at the same exact time, every single time, okay? But, so then you get to a more complicated game like Go, okay? Which a lot of Americans think is Othello. It's not. It's not. It's a 19 by 19 board, black and white chips, and the idea is, it's just, when you have 19 by 19 and a lot of different pieces, you have a huge tree of possibilities. Way too big to check every single one. Not possible. How big? After two moves in chess, you have 400 ways you could move, 400 possible moves. After two moves in Go, you have 10 to the 170th options. No, it's at 10 to the 170th ways that board could be configured at that point, okay? There are 10 to the 80th atoms in the universe. So if every atom in the universe was a universe, and every atom in those universes was a Go configuration after two moves, it would still be 10 billion times short, okay? Not gonna check all those. So it has to just get good at the game. It has to really be smart at the game. And people said it wouldn't be done, and then it was done. Now, this is the first iteration. The second iteration is way better than the first iteration. It's just completely different caliber. And then people said, well, that's still a science. How about a poker? Poker involves lying and it involves trickery. So there's an AI called Lebradas, Carnegie Mellon, and started playing all the best poker players. And it was going to be like a 4-week thing. And after like the first week, poker players were doing pretty well. They'd go home every day and they'd see what the AI was doing. They'd figure it out. They'd strategize. They would collude together. They'd come back with a different strategy. And they did pretty well for 7 days. And the AI started beating them and never looked back. And now Lebradas is the best poker player in the world. So you can go on and on, okay? But just to pause for a second here. AlphaGo started doing Space Invaders. Okay, that was the first thing it had them do. Just start with something simple, Space Invaders, and just no instructions. If it does well, it gets a feedback that something good happened. If it does badly, it gets feedback something bad happened. And at first it was just totally zany, right? Doing nothing. It didn't take even one day. Later that afternoon, it was amazing at all the Atari games that it was given. If you had a baby, a newborn, that by 4 p.m. that day was amazing at Space Invaders, you'd be freaked out. What is this baby gonna grow up into? This is the kind of thing we're talking about here. These things are all still babies. Driverless cars, so that example I said before about agriculture revolution, you have something like people can compare notes and someone learns something and they all learn it, collective intelligence. Well, driverless cars is like this. So right now there's been over 200 million miles driven on the Tesla platform, right? Now you think about it, I was in Montana once, and Montana, the asshole deers come out in the road when you're driving at night. And I ended up having to swerve and went kind of diagonally, and I got lucky, it was a flat median there, bad times. Of course I'm gonna be bad at what to do when I'm going 80 and there's a deer staring at me. And because I've just never done it before. But if I had to do it again, I might be a little bit better. If this happened to me 10 times, I'd start to know, oh, there he is, and I know what to do, okay? With the Tesla platform, every time one car sees a deer, they all see it, okay? Very soon, every driverless car has seen everything. Anything crazy that happens, the car knows what to do. Humans can't not do that, okay? So you end up with it just far superior to the driver, and cars are already far superior, and they're in their absolute infancy. Areas we don't necessarily think about, so radiology, okay? You know, one of the hardest things to get right for radiologists is mammograms, okay? It's very, very hard. And they actually get it wrong 20% of the time. Either they think someone has breast cancer or they don't, or vice versa. Those are both tragic things to get wrong, really terrible. So at Houston Methodist Hospital, they have an AI that assesses mammograms, and they basically had to go head-to-head with doctors. And after a pretty big trial, the doctors had their standard 80% right. The AI went 30 times faster and got it right 99.6% of the time. Okay, in 5 years, it's gonna be medical malpractice to not be using. It's gonna be like, just unheard of to not have AI doing these things. You never just have a human just look at your stuff, and really wouldn't need a human to look at it at all. All right, law, paralegals, they do high level work, but they had a diligence and discovery project where the AI went head to head. Okay, paralegals took 2 weeks, AI took 2 hours, all right? And this is fully indexed, repurposable, it's just not even a competition. And go on, I have 50 of these, but just putting up a few for now. Finance, okay? So most hedge funds now do most of their trading on AI. And just kind of a different thing you don't think about, JP Morgan Chase, something called the Contract Intelligence AI System, COIN they call it, that just assesses these commercial loan agreements. And this took 360,000 man hours a year. It's about 200 full-time jobs, okay? This thing does 200 people's annual jobs in minutes, okay? Obviously, those people don't have jobs anymore, and that's not even a question. It reminds me of if the world were you need to search for an email, so you had an assistant that printed out all of your whole inbox and just went through one by one trying to find it. And suddenly you come up with a new system where you can just type in the search. This is not a competition, this is not a debate. Obviously, those jobs are disappearing. Okay, so the question is this a capitalist dream or is it a labor nightmare or both? It's definitely a capitalist dream. Any groundbreaking technological advances in efficiency always are. Labor nightmare is, I think, a little harder question. Okay, there's you hear things like this, that 47% of jobs are going to disappear in the next 25 years, but you have to think about something. Okay, 100 years ago, 90% of the American workforce was in some way working in the food industry to feed America, somewhere along that chain. Today, it's 2% from 90. So if you told someone that there's going to be 2% people working in food, not 90, in 100 years, you'd say, oh my God, 88% of jobs are disappearing. But that would be missing kind of the big story here, right? That obviously as the world advances enough to replace those jobs, it advances enough to open up a bunch of new ones. This is throughout history, you see this. You have the people, the Luddites, resisted the loom, but then more people bought clothes, new industries happened. There was the steam engine, okay? And think about all the things that opened, the Industrial Revolution, okay? Suddenly you have trains, you have, boats, and you can factories blow up, and you have all of this. The assembly line, you can keep going. Obviously, one of the biggest ones, electricity. Electricity comes around and infiltrates everything. Okay, it's nowhere, and then like 15 years later, it's everywhere. Okay, I mean that doesn't just open up the world of electronics. You have the motion picture industry, for example, and all the things that come from that. When you have the car, that also opens up McDonald's and Holiday Inn and suburbia and things you don't think about. So this is called the Budding effect, because this dude, Wilbur Budding, in 1827, invented the lawnmower. Because of him, we have a $500 billion a year worldwide sports industry now that relies on cut grass. Can't have that without that. You know, you keep going. So you have to imagine that something as big a deal as AI, which is going to infiltrate everything the same exact way electricity, it's going to be suddenly everywhere, even more than it is now. This is going to obviously open up a ton of new opportunities, new jobs. Now, a lot of jobs will get replaced, and some people say, well, this is different than all those examples. This is just fundamentally different, and maybe it is, but you have to think that more jobs than not are going to be enhanced than replaced. The ones that are going to be replaced, there will be a bunch of new jobs coming up. Productivity in general is going to get a lot better. I'm not that worried about 2025. I'm excited for it. We're gonna prosper because of all this stuff. I think this is gonna be really good from what I've learned. I think that most people are gonna do great. After that, it gets dicey. Now here is when we just don't really know what the hell is gonna happen, okay? Because now we get to artificial general intelligence. We have this concept, which I haven't even mentioned it. Everything I just said still has nothing to do with general intelligence. Now we have AI, picture AI that is smart like a human is smart. It's there, it's looking at you, it's in the room with you, it's there, and it knows what's going on. That is weird, never experienced anything like that before, okay? That is so fundamentally foreign to us that all we can do is be simpletons who apply what we know to intelligence, we just apply it to AI, so we always anthropomorphize. We always think it's gonna be like a person that wants power, or wants. Those are all very silly ways to think about AI. It is fundamentally not, it's not even, if you made a spider kind of like human level intelligent, bad times, right? We don't want that around. But it would still, even though it's so different, it would want what a spider wants, it wouldn't become a human. It would still be a spider deep down. That's really different, but it's biology. Its DNA is actually still really similar. This thing, AI, is not at all biology. It has nothing, it's just a fundamentally different thing, but it's also just as smart as we are, way smarter. What the hell, okay? It's very confusing to me. So, question is, chill out. That was just very upsetting what just happened. AI didn't like where I was going with this. So, how do we get to AGI? How do we get to artificial general intelligence? This is what I spent some time asking a lot of questions, and it's changing, there's new techniques all the time, because no one really knows. It's a little like trying to build the internet, and you're trying to figure out how people are doing it. There's a lot of different ways something can happen. But to understand at least the general, why it's so hard, okay? Because it just seems like, well, why should it be so hard? Why is it so much harder than narrow intelligence? And so we have to think about, because it's easy for us, we kind of forget how hard it actually is, how impressive our brains actually are. And general intelligence is a magical thing. And so if you think about it, one of the things that is, specifically the things that we think are hard are actually the things that are not hard to do for AI. We just learned those in the last 1,000 years or so. For example, like engineering, calculus, that's not hard to program AI that's better than us at. Walking, not easy. Walking is an extremely complex physics problem. To try to get something to be able to walk on two legs is very, very difficult, for example. Or you could say say to an AI, I want you to beat the world chess master in chess. And the AI is like, did that 20 years ago, no problem, I'll do it in like an eighth of a second. And you say, okay, also, what does this say? And the AI says, shit. Now, why? Why can someone beat Garry Kasparov in chess and not be able to read that? Okay? And the reason is, again, it's intuitive to us. Well, it just says Broadway, no problem. Well, if you're going to build a program that tells me, that can always tell you what a B is, You have a child's B, you have a calligraphy B, you have different fonts, you have a capital B, you have a big, you know, block letter B, cursive. I mean, it's suddenly you're like, oh man, how are we gonna do it? It's really, really hard. That's why these things work. Okay, you know, you can say to the AI, I want you to memorize every street in the world to integrate it with real-time satellite data, you know, taking into account all these other factors, and tell me how to, you know, get from one place to another. And the AI said, not hard. You know, this is very easy, small world, simple number of streets, just some information. And you say, okay, but just before you start that, is this a dog or a cat? And the AI is like, Jesus! It's really hard for an AI to figure out what a dog versus a cat is, or what a dog is in general. And dogs are weird, by the way. They are very odd looking, because we've bred them into these like shapes that we like against their will. But this is the kind of thing we think is easy, you know, facial recognition. Yeah, no problem. No, that's really impressive. Your brain is magical that it can do that. Okay? It's, you know, until you got into programming, you wouldn't realize how hard it is to tell an AI what a dog is, but like, you know, like, not easy. Okay, an AI doesn't see with all the nuance you see. The AI sees all these identical pictures. Okay? So, this goes, as I said, for walking, for reaching, and I reach to get something. That is my hand moving in a vector that has an X, Y, Z axis, multiple joints moving all at once. That is really fancy engineering going on. Again, that's really hard to build. This vision, you know, so this is you know, it's basically can do everything we do without thinking. Everything we can do with thinking, because thinking is we're not very good at. But all the intuitive stuff we can do without thinking, that's 3.8 billion years of evolution. Who made this fancy computer? That's what it can't do. If you see this, you're gonna say, okay, that's a black, you know, rectangle with some gray and some lighter gray and squares and no big deal. And the AI says, yeah, I agree, I see the same thing. So you say, okay, lift up black, and you have this thing. And you say, oh, no, it wasn't that. You were tricking me, it has like these three-dimensional things, it's like cylinders. The AI is like, huh, no, that's still two-dimensional things. It's like AI still just sees two-dimensional shapes. Your brain's doing very fancy work to render what that's supposed to represent in the three-dimensional world, okay? You know, you see a black rock, big deal. The AI sees a two-dimensional collage of white, gray, and black, okay? It's very hard. So how do we do it? How do we start to get here? There's a hardware challenge and a software challenge. So the hardware side, the brain is really, really impressive. And it's not that it's fast. Neurons actually are very slow compared to the speed that information can travel. It's just the sheer kind of computational power, the calculations it can do per second. You need a computer that is like the size of a building right now, and there actually is one in China that can basically do what a human brain can do, but it's huge. It's actually made of a bunch of individual computers. Computers can't do anything near this, okay? But you know, so in the computer you can buy for $1,000, maybe does about 1/1000th of our calculations per second. So it seems like it's far away. But 1985, the best computer that you can buy for $1,000 could do 1/1000000th of what the brain could do. 1995, it was 1/1000000th. 2005, it was 1/1000000th. Today, it's less than 1/1000th, and you realize, okay, no, oh, we're a few years away. We're not 1,000 times away. This is going to happen. By 2065, if this, you know, Moore's Law or something similar to it continues, you're going to end up being able to buy a computer for $1,000 that has the power of all human brains combined. The software side's even harder. How do you, okay, so now you the hardware's going to get there. Quantum computing, something. Someone's going to figure out how to get the hardware in there. How do we do the software? Okay, how do you make it smart? How do you make it learn what it needs to learn? Okay, so there's a few ways people are doing it. One way is, well, we have a prototype. We literally have a general intelligence computer on the planet. Let's copy it, okay? So you have things like neural nets, people are building. You have whole brain emulation, which is really advanced tech, which is literally slicing a brain into, you know, very, very thin two-dimensional things and then uploading them to a computer and running them together and, you know, very far away. But that would be cool. Then you could literally, like, upload your consciousness. This is what people are, this is what would be, you know, uploaded. You'd be in the computer. So some people say, well, let's forget the brain. How about the thing that made it? Let's just copy the process of making it. So it actually plagiarizes evolution with genetic algorithms. So it'll actually, you know, take different algorithms, have them try something. The ones that don't do well get discontinued. The ones that do well get kind of combined. They get mated. And you end up with really ingenious solutions to problems that are weird that you never would have come up with. Which that really actually works. Which is like evolution. Evolution is odd. Your whole body is a pile of mistakes. It's a pile of mutations. That's it. Every single thing that makes you is a mutation that someone else had that happened to you. So you start to get to some of these things here. Okay? Self-improvement is the most intense. But once it gets to a certain level, maybe we can say, let's just not do it ourselves. Let's have the computer bootstrap itself, and like it'll just do the job for us, and we'll teach it to research AI and to not just change its own knowledge, not just learn, but to actually change its own architecture, okay? To make itself smarter. Either way, what probably is gonna happen, given the Moore's Law on the hardware side, exponential, we're not good at exponential, remember, and on the software side, the fact that one tweak, one genius kind of new breakthrough can suddenly have this move forward very quickly, this is likely going to sneak up on us. It's gonna surprise us. Especially since we don't, you know, again, this is studying AI will be a good lesson in how actually bad our intuition is at understanding reality. Because it didn't make 50,000 years ago, reality wasn't important for your survival, so our brains aren't good at it. What was important was fitting in with the tribe and hating that other tribe enough that when one tribe is the dicker tribe that kills the other one, that's the one you're in so that you survive. Because the ones that were nice aren't here anymore. Our brains are very wired for a specific, optimized for something that just has nothing to do with understanding the reality of our own intelligence, for example. So here's how we think, okay? We look and we're like, you know, Einstein really smart, okay? But like a dumb human, like a five-year-olds are dumb. So a five-year-old is way dumber than Einstein, and then you have like a chimp and, you know, bird, no, their animals are down there, you know, they're less smart. It's not true, that's not what it's like. So when AI is actually working its way up here, and oh my god, AI kind of do what ants can do. AI can do what birds can do. Oh my god, AI can do what a chimp can do. We're gonna think it's doing cute monkey tricks. We're not gonna think it's a big deal. But it's actually soaring upwards towards us at a ridiculous rate when this is happening. Because this is actually what intelligence looks like, okay? The five-year-old and the Einstein are almost identically intelligent as far as the actual biological scale is concerned, okay? And so, it's gonna go from the chimp, then it's gonna hit dumb human. We're gonna say, oh my god, look, the AI is playing with the kids. It's so cute. It's doing what if I was painting. That knight is smarter than everyone, ever. When did that happen? Okay? It's gonna be very surprising. Suddenly he's smarter than Einstein. Suddenly the AI goes from painting, you know, his R's backwards adorably to figuring out the string theory problem. Done. Easy. No problem. Like 7 hours later. That could happen, okay? This is crazy, okay? So we come back here and we say, well, what's gonna happen if AI catches up? So AI, you know, it starts to move up. And I'm saying move up in intelligence, I am talking here, not about magnitude as much as I'm talking about this concept of getting that breadth and then combining it with magnitude, okay, at the same time. That's how you get to human level intelligence. Now, once it hits kind of this human level intelligence, you know, it's not gonna stay here. It's not gonna just stop at that station and chill. It's gonna soar by us. Why wouldn't it? Okay, it has every advantage possible over us at that point. Our brains are physically limited in size by our size of our skull, but also by the fact that neuron information moves so slowly that if the brain were too much bigger, it wouldn't be able to communicate from one side to the other fast enough to function as one cohesive unit. An AI brain has to be the size of a dwarf planet before you have that same problem, okay? So it can get far, far bigger. It's editable, we're not. It's upgradable, okay? It doesn't forget things, we do. It has perfect collective intelligence. So the whole advantage we have over animals with language and cities that allowed us to have, you know, build skyscrapers, and you know, not one human knows how to do that, but collectively we do. The AI's collective abilities are way, 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 way beyond that. They can instantly sync with all other AIs in that same industry to be, you know, perfect at what they do. So you can just go on and on with the reasons this thing is gonna have a massive advantage. And if it's coding itself, okay, if its job is to code itself, it might get really damn smart. Because remember, when AI is good at something, think about chess, think about Go, think about driving. When it does get good at something, it gets way better than us, not even a question. So when it gets smart in general, it's going to get way better than us at being smart in general. We call this point super intelligence. It is general intelligence, but it's so much higher than ours that we really should have a different word for it. It's something we don't understand what it would be like to either be something that has that kind of cognitive capacity or to coexist with something that does. We have no idea what that's going to be like. And so the question is, when is this going to happen? And how's it going to go? Okay, so the when question, the takeoff speed. So you have AI hits this kind of general intelligence level, and then this takeoff speed is the term for getting from there to like a crazy level. Okay, does it happen, say, 20 years? Does it take 10 minutes? We don't know. But again, this self-improvement thing becomes very relevant suddenly. Because when the AI is smarter than Einstein, Einstein would have been a pretty sick computer programmer if he's all he cared about. Now imagine this thing is smarter than Einstein and its only mission is to make itself smarter. Okay? Have something we call an intelligence explosion. So go back. So here we have an intelligence staircase, okay? Scientific. So there's humans. Is this? Oh, laser. So fun. Okay, so you have a human. And then you have like a chimp, just say, okay. Now, two steps. We are, again, if you're just looking at like the broad range of, you know, what is intelligence? Some form of information processing. If you're looking at the whole range, humans and chimps are almost the same level. We're really close. Two steps, let's say. Those two steps go a long way, okay? Not only can a chimp not do what we can do, not only can it not build this building, or, you know, night sky, you look at little lights moving around, satellites and airplanes, okay? We put lights in the sky, that's how smart we are. That's ridiculous, we're an animal. We are a biological animal that put lights in the sky. That is amazing. Not only can a monkey not do that, but if you show the monkey the light in the sky, it just assumes it's a star moving around. It can't even understand that we did it, even if you tried to explain it. So how about when you have an AI that gets here, two steps above us, including all the, you know, collective intelligence advantages over us that we have, over just all the things that are kind of magnified here, two steps above us. Not only is it going to be able to do stuff and solve problems that we can't, it might be so high level that we literally can't even understand what it did or that it did it, even if it tried to explain it. That's crazy. That's not like, there's just no way. Like trying to understand this is like a chimp trying to understand what it's like to invent humans. They're gonna be thinking, oh wow, like this will be a really smart ape that's even better at cracking coconuts. Like, it's just gonna apply what it knows and try to make it a little smarter. That's what we do. We say it's gonna be like, it's gonna have like a way to communicate through wavelengths. Yeah, that's like cute. That's like what humans would think that a smart thing would do. It's gonna do stuff that we just don't even fundamentally have the capacity to understand and that we don't have yet. Maybe we can develop. Maybe we are computers in a way that monkeys are not, in a way that we can learn. We don't know, that's a big debate. But whether there's something we just never could understand or whether with enough explaining, enough time, a human brain could. But either way, it's gonna be crazy. And then, remember this thing, all it's trying to do is make itself smarter. You know how easy that is for something this smart? It's just gonna just start jumping up the steps. And if it jump up the steps, this could happen in one day, it could be suddenly up here. The whole last slide is this, okay? So it doesn't matter if you're religious or not, there's God on the planet now. Okay, this thing, you know, think about the God-like power we have over animals, just for being a little bit smarter. Again, let's take a chimp. This poor chimp is getting drawn into this. But, so he's pretty damn smart, right? A really, really intelligent animal. We put a cage around him, now he's smart. What are you gonna do? You take him out of the cage, I lock the door. I have a taser, how are you gonna handle that? I have a gun, I can poison your food. The monkey's got nothing. The monkey is totally at my whim. I can play God then just because I'm a little bit smarter. So this thing up there clearly can do whatever. And so this is the big question that then I always get to is, okay, so when? And is this a good God or is it one of those like dick gods from the Old Testament or whatever? And that's a really important question. It's like the most important question that there could be if you're a human being. So as far as the when question, you have some people that think we are right on the cusp of something crazy here. Other people think it's farther away. Nick Bostrom and some others conducted a pretty broad survey across the people know a lot about AI, and this includes a bunch of people who are more skeptical than the average public, and a bunch of people who are more bullish than the average public, so it's interesting. And they basically asked the question, among others, when do you think it's more likely, or when, at what year in the future would you say it's now 50% likely that we have general intelligence on this planet? And then they also have the same question for superintelligence. So basically, estimate when you think it's more likely than not. That it's happened, that it's here. okay? And they took them, and the median answers were here. 2040 and 2060, okay? That's really soon. That's really soon. You guys are gonna be around. Some of you will be dead, which is odd, but it's most of you. Some of you will be around. 2060, a lot of us will be around in 2060, especially if AI could help us be around for a lot longer than that. So anyway, this is crazy. And again, some people said a lot earlier, some people said a lot later. And you can see the average kind of takeoff speed ended up being kind of 20 years. So some people think it's not gonna take one day, but a lot of people do. We just don't know. We've never done this before. It's totally unprecedented. We don't know how to make this. We don't know how fast it's gonna get smart. We don't know what it's gonna be like when it gets smart. We don't know how to make it safe. We don't even know how it works now. You know, I was talking to people who make AI recently, and they were saying no one on the planet understands, just like how it said, you know, there's no one that can, no one understands how even the current AIs work because there's so many moving parts. It's millions of different systems, and a lot of it's kind of, it just works the way it does, and they did it. And that, no one really fully understands it now, let alone here, okay? So then we get to the question, okay, is this gonna be good? Is this gonna be the best thing ever? Or is it gonna be very, very, very upsetting? So I kind of made this thing, that's how I think about like an expert. I kind of plot them on here somewhere. And I read this. I'm not an expert on this. What I did is I read what hundreds of experts say, talked to a bunch of them, read a bunch of their books, watched a bunch of their interviews, and I keep doing that. It's the best I can do, that's the best anyone can do. First, I was like, why am I doing a talk on AI? Like, I'm not an AI person, I don't know it. And then it hit me, I was like, no one is an AI person. No one knows what the hell they're talking about. So if I can at least sum up what our simpleton species is saying about it right now, then that's as good as anything we can do because there's just no one quite knows. Here's where I find people all over the place on this. And that's how you know our species doesn't know what it's talking about, is when the experts are all over the place and contradicting each other, contradicting themselves and changing their minds. But you know, good or bad for us versus kind of irrelevant in the middle, and then is it gonna happen sooner or later versus, you know, I don't know. And so I found people clustered though. I plotted everyone for a while, and they seem to be clustered in two areas. One, what I call confident corner. Okay, these are the people that say it's gonna happen really soon, and it's gonna be awesome. Like Ray Kurzweil is a famous one. But there's a lot of them. Peter Diamond, there's a lot of people in this city who work in it. They work in it because they're in a confident corner. They feel great about it. They think it's gonna change everything for the better. DeepMind feels amazing about it. And they think it's gonna happen really soon, like sooner than anyone has said so far. Like 10 years soon, craziness. And so these people basically think, we're gonna have, this is the deal. This is about what's about to happen. And this is true. I mean, if AI, and they use the term friendly AI, it doesn't mean that it's like nice and like affable. It means friendly means it's aligned with human values and goals, okay? So if it is, okay, and it's kind of doing what we want it to do, every problem that we can imagine, all the problems we toil about, we have poverty, we have climate change, we have disease, cancer, you know, you have mortality, none of this is hard to something super, super smart. None of this is hard. It's like a monkey trying to open a padlock forever, just hitting itself against it, and we can come look at the instructions and see the code and open it. It's that easy. Things like cancer, you know, chemo, it's gonna look so, you know, so primitive once something like this can just easily solve that problem. And again, even things like mortality, truly mortality, what the human body is, what is it? It's a machine. It's a physical machine made of little parts called cells with information in them that do functions. It's just like a more complex car. You can keep a car going forever if you keep replacing parts. Every time one gets bad, or you go fix it. Or even better, you know, you can upload us somewhere. You don't have to be attached to a dying animal anymore, which is this inconvenience we're all dealing with. So it's really exciting to think about this. And what I worried about when I researched it is that no one was gonna say, that all the people who knew were gonna be like, don't, it's gonna be bad, it's not gonna be like that. But actually, that's not true. A lot of them, I would say more than half of the experts I talked to feel really good. So a lot of them aren't sure how we're gonna make it good, but they're confident that we will, which really makes me happy. And just, you know, as a side note, I'm kind of like an atheist, dude. If you're an atheist, you have nothing to lose here. You're already in your own dystopian future. Every atheist is living in a Black Mirror episode, in this horrible episode that I watched where, oh my God, it's this world where everyone dies. At some point, you don't know when, and it's like, and you watch an episode and be like, that was too dark, even for Black Mirror. That's my current dystopian life, I'm living. So I'll take my chances, yeah, let's shake it up. You know, let's do something better. But there is a dark side, again, which I'm willing to take, to try, but it's all these people here on Anxious Avenue get very worried, okay? They talk about, it's not that they think this is definitely gonna be bad. Well, there's very few kind of like catastrophists. Like they think that this could be okay, but there's no reason to think it would be unless we, you know, we have to figure out how to do that. And they're not, a lot of them aren't that sure when it's gonna happen. Nick Bostrom's a famous one here. They don't know what's gonna happen. What they do know is that once it's here, we can't take it back any easier than to bring the chimp back in. It's like, you know, we evolved from, you know, apes that were similar to chimps, and they can't take us back, even though I'm sure a lot of animals on this planet would like to. They can't, we're here, and there's nothing anyone can do about that. We're in charge now, sorry, you lost your chance. Once we make this thing, if it doesn't want to be discontinued, it won't be. If it wants us to be discontinued, we will be, okay? So Anxious Avenue is scary because you get one crack, and anyone who works in software knows that, or anyone who uses software knows that 1.0 is not very good, usually it's buggy, okay? But what if you only get a chance to do 1.0, and 1.0 is the everlasting eternal God, and it's buggy? It's unfortunate. But, you know, so a lot of people think, oh, they're probably scared that bad guys will get a hold of it. And they are, that is scary. Or even just that one entity will get a hold of it. Yes, that is scary. Or weapons. You know, that weapons are really scary, which is actually narrow intelligence, but it's terrifying. You know, there's basically, just, you know, I hear that you can kind of, gunpowder is one great advance in weaponry, and the only one comparable to that so far is nuclear technology. And basically, autonomous weapons would be a third whole new paradigm shift, and you know, the possibilities are terrifying. I think nukes are terrifying, this is way more terrifying. And yet that's not what they're scared of. Okay? That's not what they think is the real worry. The worry for them is that we're a bunch of little kids. This stopped working. There we go. We're a bunch of little kids playing with a bomb that we don't understand, which I think I've hopefully made clear that we are. They just worry that, you know, you have these examples like the paperclip scenario that people talk about where, you know, some lab says we're going to create an AI and its only job is to get raw materials and has to turn them into paperclips, as many as it can in a day or whatever it is. And we give it a simple, quantifiable metric that we can judge its own intelligence by, and then we have it self-improve its own intelligence. And so the kind of dystopian nightmare there is that starts to get to our level. Just like, there's nothing you can do to tell a human or convince them to make them want to jump off a cliff, mostly. Because our core programming says, no matter what you do, don't jump off a cliff, period, okay? So the AI wants to make paper clips as much as you don't want to jump off a cliff, because it's its core programming. So it's gonna see humans coming in, no, it's gonna start to know what's going on, it's gonna start to say, humans are gonna try to change my task, because it's just a test task. And that's gonna feel like getting pushed off a cliff to that AI, and it's gonna do whatever it can to avoid it, and it's gonna, maybe that's getting rid of humans, maybe that's hiding its own intelligence, but all it wants is to make paperclips, and now it's really good at it, and it starts to need atoms to make them. We have atoms in our bodies, and so does everything else. And then in 50 years, the whole planet is just a mass of paperclips, and there's drones heading out to other planets, turning the galaxy into paperclips, because someone botched it. So it's this kind of like weird scenario is just an example of the kind of things that these AI experts talk about when they get scared, is unintended consequences with something that has such tremendous power that we can't afford an unintended consequence. And it's, you know, again, it's not that it hates us, it's not that it wants power, that's anthropomorphizing, that's applying human values and characteristics to a fundamentally non-human thing. It's more like we want to build a house and there's an anthill on the ground. We don't kill all those ants because we hate the ants. Now we showed you. We build the house because we're doing our thing and it's in the way. So the fears that we're in the way are one of these many fears like this. And so it's both really terrifying and unsettling, and I think really exciting at the same time. But either way, you know, people say it's the last invention we'll ever make, the last challenge we'll ever face, because if it's on our side, it'll invent everything for us, and if it's not, then extinct species don't invent anything, so we're fine. And, you know, regardless, just to come back from the helicopter here and just kind of hope I've convinced you that this really kind of is probably what's happening, and I don't know what you want to do with that information. That's not my problem, but I just want to at least have a discussion. So thank you.